Okay, hello, welcome everybody. So now something a little bit different. You heard something about infiltration, storage of water, how you can use the aquifer. And now we change the topic a little bit. We are going to tracers. So how can you observe your aquifer and what is going on there? And so I want to tell you something about environmental behavior and fate of Atzazul Farm. And that's about laboratory experiments. Okay, so the background. Can we use Atzazul Farm as a tracer just to investigate, for example, the proportion of bank filtrate that we abstract from a bank filtrate well? And do we have some restrictions in the use of this potential tracer? Does it maybe depend on the site or on several environmental conditions? So here is the system. And okay, you know it, you have the river, you have a well near to the river bank, and you have the land-sided groundwater. There's usually a mixture of these both water sources. And we are interested in the proportion of the bank filtrate in the end to take a look how much impact we have from the surface water, whether we have to expect some contamination, microbial problems, and so on and so on. Okay, Atzazul Farm, what is it? It is a very small molecule. It is used as an artificial sweetener for beverages, for example, dietary food. It is often used as a potassium salt. The sweetening power is 200 times that of usual sugar that you use, of saccharose. It has quite high water solubility, and it is usually occurring as an anion in the environment in typical conditions due to the low acid constant. Okay, as I mentioned, Atzazul Farm is used in dietary products, for example, these light products. You can sweeten your coffee with this when you do not want to use conventional sugar. And the per capita consumption is quite high. So we have approximately 6 to 12 milligrams per day and person in Germany. That's quite a lot. And in Switzerland and in other countries, it's quite similar. So what do we find when we take a look to the rivers? That's some example from the Rhine River that you can see. It's just different sites within Germany. The red curve, that's not the Rhine, that's a tributary of the Rhine. That's the river Main near Frankfurt. And here we can see we have concentrations ranging from approximately half a microgram per liter to 4 micrograms per liter. That is quite a lot for a trace compound or a micropollutant. And if you take a look to the Danube catchment, this is from the Joint Danube Survey 3. That's the profile along the Danube. So we start on the left side in Germany, and on the right side we end up in the Black Sea. And here in the Danube, in the main river, we had concentrations between half a microgram per liter and a little bit, up to 1 microgram per liter approximately. If we take a look to the tributaries, it's similar as in the Rhine catchment. We had much higher concentrations, up to 3 microgram per liter here. And we did a previous survey, and there we had up to 8 micrograms per liter in tributaries. And that is what you can find in small streams in Germany. You have even sometimes more, you have up to 10 micrograms per liter, and at some sites even this is exceeded. So we have quite high concentrations. The reporting limit is just 10 nanograms per liter, so we can really detect small amounts or small proportions of water that contains Atzazul Farm, and due to its use as a sweetener in every household, you have this large concentrations in surface water, and so you can more or less track the wastewater impact in your bank filtrate. But are there some restrictions? So we did some sorption studies just to determine the properties of azosulfam. We used different soils. We exposed the sorbate for different times, and we used different concentrations. So in the end, we concluded that the sorption is negligible, and the KD of azosulfam is very low. It was estimated to be less than 0.1 cubic centimeter per gram. That's so you do not have to consider sorption as a major source of losses. What about degradation? So we set up some fixed bed reactor experiment, which you can see here. We pumped water from a tank with the azosulfam. Here in this glass bottle, that's a storage tank. Then we have a filter bed, which you can see here. On this filter bed, a biofilm will develop, and we can just see what happens. Is there some degradation going on or not? And this filter bed has a very low sorption properties. It's from glass beads. So we exclude the sorption here, and we just investigate the biodegradation. So usually we use drinking water, tap water, and surface water for this experiment. And my colleague had conducted such experiments. He did not find any hint for biodegradation of azosulfam. And now the idea was, okay, what is about different matrices? So we extracted soil and compost, which have much more organic matter. And so we get more DOC, we get a different spectrum of the microbial community that we can expect in this extract from this soil and compost material. And we tested diluted wastewater treatment plant effluent. So it's treated water and the nutrient content is not too high, but we have a different microbial community in this water. And here you can see the results. So you see the red dots and the yellow rectangles, that's the compost and the soil. It's more or less a straight line, so we have a recovery of 100%. We did not observe any losses with these matrices, with say high DOC and with more nutrients inside, with nitrate and everything. But then you see the blue triangles. These two curves here, and that was a diluted wastewater treatment plant effluent. And here we did really observe a complete degradation of azosulfam after approximately 20 days. So it took some time for the system to adapt, but then we had a very rapid degradation of azosulfam, and we repeated the experiment several times. So here you can see the next curve. On the right side, we added the azosulfam again to make sure it was really some effect and not something artificial. And we got even a more rapid degradation of azosulfam. So, but then we went a little bit further. We had some column flow-through experiments with large columns, which you can see here. Height is approximately 1 meter, diameter 25 centimeters, and we used several groundwaters here, we used the surface water, we used oxic groundwater and anoxic groundwater for these experiments, and operated these columns for several months and conducted several experiments. So the first was a pulse type injection of azosulfam and sodium chloride concentrated solutions, and we just followed what happens in these columns. And so here you can see the breakthrough of these both tracers of azosulfam and of the sodium chloride. And you can notice these both curves here, the solid lines with the symbols. This is the breakthrough in two columns of the azosulfam. And it is a little bit before, even before the sodium chloride breakthrough, which you can see here with the dotted lines. Yeah. So and we had a recovery of nearly 100%. So this indicates there was nothing happening in this flow-through columns, no sorption, no degradation. It behaved almost like the sodium chlorate. So from this point, we would say, okay, it's a very nice tracer, we can use it, we have no problem, even if we have different types of waters here. Here you can see the recovery again from the pulse injection. That's what I just mentioned. We had recoveries close to 100%. Then we made a modeling just to make a prediction of this transport that we had observed here. And you can see the model and the data that we had observed, they fit quite well. So from, and we did not use any degradation in this modeling. It was just modeled with dispersion. And here, then we made some continuous amantment, not just a pulse type, but a continuous amantment, both of sodium chlorate and of the azosulfam. And here again, you can see the breakthrough of azosulfam. This is the red curves, is a little bit earlier than of the sodium chlorate. That's maybe some effect due to the electrical conductivity which we used, or which is plotted here. And you can see for both, we have again recoveries close to 100%. So from this experiment, we would conclude, okay, it's quite good tracer, it behaves quite conservative. Now, more experiments. We monitored or we operated the system at background concentrations with the different waters, with the oxic surface water, with the oxic groundwater, which is the blue columns here, and with anoxic groundwater, this is the orange columns. And again, you can see on the left of both bars in the same color is always the input of the system, and the right bar is the output. There is very little difference. So from this, we would conclude again, even if we have a long-term operation of these columns, azosulfam behaves quite conservative. There are little concentration changes. Okay, it's a conservative tracer. But, or to conclude now, we have observed negligible sorption of azosulfam. It proved to be stable in flow-through column studies. With the fixed bed reactor experiments, it's the same. We did not have degradation with the soil and the compost extracts. That's under rather eutrophic conditions. But then, in one experiment with a diluted wastewater treatment plant effluent, we observed a quite rapid and repeated degradation of azosulfam. So this means under these more oligotrophic nutrient conditions with a different composition of the microbial community, we really observed a complete degradation of azosulfam. And this was quite surprising for us and puts some doubt on the assumption that it is stable and that you can really use it as a tracer in every site. Yeah? And yeah, just to give some small outlook, we conducted some studies at several bank filtration sites, and there we could really observe this effect in the environment. So at bank filtration sites, azosulfam is not always stable. You have really sites where you have considerable reductions of azosulfam concentration, which is not due to sorption and which is not due to dilution. It's really a degradation. Okay, so I want to acknowledge the funding of the study from our organization. And well, I want to thank my colleagues which supported the study and you for your attention. Thank you.